I'm excited to be coming to you today from just the comfort of my home into your home. We've been telling you, make your home a sanctuary. Since all of our quarantine and since all of this started back in early March, you have done just that. So thank you for making your home a sanctuary. I reserved a few, just a few expressions of gratitude for this reason. In our time away, I made a conscious effort to completely unplug and enjoy our time of refreshing and rejuvenation with our family. Again, our staff has been doing an amazing job, our admin team, our media team, our kids team for the continued online kids services and the kids gathering, our youth team, our outreach team, all of the teams that just make New Hope happen. I got back and I was so overwhelmed just at the job that our pastors and our team do. So I love you guys. And right from your house, can we just give all of our teams a hand clap of praise saying thank you, thank you, thank you for the work that they do. While I was away, I intentionally did not take my computer. And while I was away, we spent time at home for a couple of weeks in three different areas that we love. We spent time on the river. We spent time down in at Tina's mom and dad on the lake and on the farm. And while we were on the river, my phone went down like the Titanic. So I didn't have my computer. I didn't have my phone. I was completely unplugged. And really, like our declaration says, I was without distraction. I got into a book that I've been wanting to read. And I really was just leaving myself open for the Lord to speak to me, but yet refresh. There's a difference in resting, and I go away on a study break and we kind of line out what we're going to be teaching year over year, although this year has just been crazy. We've kind of veered a lot this year. But I take a study break and a spiritual study break, but I also take a rest. So in my rest, I try not to read too much into leadership and try not to think too much. But I really, without distraction, just ask the Lord, God, if there's a word in its simplicity that you want to reveal to me for New Hope people, just for this season right here, share that with me. And the word, the only word that I got from God was this, was just to pause and have a deeper sense of gratitude. Now I'm going to hit that word today, gratitude. Because I came home grateful for all of our team, our church, our family, our friends who spoke for us. I came home thankful for forgiveness and salvation. I came home thankful for the very things that we've been praying, peace, protection, and provision. So much to be grateful for. And I think when we're in it, we don't realize how much that we have to be grateful for. And over the last couple of weeks, my family and I, we were just able to pause and say, thank you, God. We give you glory and honor and praise, and most of all, gratitude. Now, stay with me here. Get your Bible and your journal because we're going to share some scripture. There's a theme in the Bible that appears in so many places. And particularly, I'm going to tell you about what Paul writes to several of the churches. It's like he's writing to the church, to the churches that he's visited or planted. And there's a theme toward gratitude to the church and the letters that he's written to these churches. Let's start with 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16 through 18. It says this, and I'm going to dial in on some key words, okay? It says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. What a great passage for us in this season. He also writes to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19 through 20. It says, make music from your heart and to the Lord. And here it is, always giving thanks. Thanks to God, the Father, for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And then he writes to the church in Colossae, or the Colossians, and he reiterates the theme of gratitude three times in this passage right here over two verses. Colossians chapter 3, verse 15 through 17. And it starts like this. And be thankful. Would you just say that with me? And be thankful. It says, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach And you admonish one another. So as I'm teaching and as we admonish one another and lift each other up, it says, do this with all wisdom through psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, so whether we are saying it or doing it, it says, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus. And here it is again, the third time, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Can you say amen for that? So gratitude is key. And here's the title of the sermon, Training for Gratitude. You're like, can we train for gratitude? Let's train for gratitude today. Let's turn our minds toward gratitude. We're going to take several exercises and put them into practice today. Maybe there are people God will bring into your mind, maybe a family member, or a coworker, or a teacher over the course of this message. Maybe there's an experience. Maybe there's a place, getting to go to school or getting to go to work or getting to travel or somewhere that you've been that you can say, wow, I am grateful for that. Maybe there's a time when you were suffering and God, comforted you. That's something to be grateful for. Think of all of the small gifts, maybe that somebody has bestowed upon you or sent your way, an encouraging word, a note, a phone call, a text. Think of a good night's rest. Think of food that you love to eat or a financial blessing that you've received. Can we just pause and say, God, I am so grateful for those simple and small things. Let's think about things that have been life-changing gifts in our lives. Think about faith. Think about the Bible. Think about the death of Jesus on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. Think about the gift of the Holy Spirit as a guide and for spiritual gifts that God gives us, not only to us, but to other people for our benefit. Think about your church and your community. I'm grateful that no matter what, we've been able to continue to join online. Have you given God any gratitude for the fact that we're still joined together as the church? You see, all of these things we can be grateful for. And throughout the message, I'm going to give you the thoughts, but I want you to test them. I want you to put them to the test and see if they prove to be true in your lives in the weeks to come. Maybe God will nudge you with something that you're grateful for. And when he does, you know what? Just take out that pen, take your Bible out right now and your journal or your device and just write those down and say, God, I'm just overwhelmed with gratefulness. Hit us on Facebook or hit us on our chat room, hit us on Instagram and just make a post and hashtag New Hope People or give us an at mention saying, hey, I'm grateful for this. And we'll all see gratitude kind of come to life in all of us today. Now, here's a few things that I want to give you on how to train for gratitude, okay? Here's my first point today. Number one, to train for gratitude, you got to understand gratitude flows from God's presence. When we're grateful, we recognize that we're thankful because of God's presence in our lives. First and foremost, ladies and gentlemen, more gratitude will not come from acquiring more things. Gratitude comes from more awareness of God's presence and from God's goodness. Are you ready? God is good. And everybody say, all of the time. You see, God was so good to us to provide his son Jesus as an example that would give us a framework and some training for gratitude because Jesus was grateful. But it's important to know what gratitude is. And here's what gratitude is today. Get this. It's the perception of the good in the earth. You cannot manufacture gratitude by willpower, even though a lot of people try to do it. No, you have to perceive the goodness of God in the earth. Even in the midst of things that are not good, you have to find things that are good that God continually provides for us. You see, gratitude is a byproduct of the way that we see things. You want to change your life? Change how you see things. You have to see the good even in the midst of things that aren't good. And it involves seeing these things. There are three elements that I think God wants us to see when it comes to gratitude and his presence as he is with us. We have to see the benefits, the benefactor, and the beneficiary. Now, these elements all come from, there's a root word there that comes from the Latin word bene, okay? It's B-E-N-E, and it's Latin, and it means good. I remember being in French when I was taking French in high school, and they would say très bien, bien, B-I-E-N also means good. For all of you who speak Spanish, it's the same, B-I-E-N, it means good, or we would say Trabian when I was learning French, which is very good. It's the same thing. All of those are derived from the Latin word bene. And these elements come from that, and it always, gratitude always involves these three things. Okay, let me break this down for you. First, let's talk about these three, the benefits. First, gratitude involves benefits. That means God has some good things for you in your life. When you get a job, they tell you what your salary is going to be and what you're going to be making, and they're giving you a package that'll help you build a life or a lifestyle. And inevitably, what's our next question? What are the benefits? What are the benefits, or the bennies, you know? What are the bennies that I'm going to get from this job? And benefits are gifts. They're gifts from God. Our lives are filled with benefits from God. And sometimes we don't perceive them. It's perception. We don't recognize what those gifts are. We're blind to them most of the time. And gratitude requires that we recognize and perceive those benefits. And here it is. Most of us are looking for big benefits. We're looking for the big package. We're looking for the big payoff. When we fail to recognize that God is oftentimes in the smallest of benefits first. Benefits from the smallest to the greatest. And you have to know that they're all good. While the good ones are great, when the big benefits are great when they get to us, I'm telling you, life is more full of a bunch of small benefits that have allowed us to know that God is good, even in times when we need the big benefits. I believe as you pay attention, ladies and gentlemen, to the small benefits that you receive every day on a day-to-day basis, then you are going to be overwhelmed with the big benefits that God is going to bestow on you and your house. Can I get a good amen out of that? Look at the small benefits, all right? I believe as you pay attention, you're going to have to train your mind. You have to train your heart and your eyes to see them and receive them as gifts from a good God. Be careful not to get an I deserve it attitude. You know, we talk a lot about entitlement in this generation when it comes to gifts and benefits that we receive. But don't get an I deserve it. In order for me to be truly grateful, I have to receive the benefit or the gift and not forget that it has been provided for me from someone or somewhere. I was always grateful that I got paid from a job, but I was also always grateful that my job provided insurance for me, because they didn't have to, but they did that for me, that they gave me a bonus at Christmas time or whatever that may be. And I didn't fail to say, hey, thank you for that, because sometimes we can just take that for granted. And God wants to give you those benefits. And I believe that as you notice the small benefits in your life, God will allow you not to forget any of those as you lead up to big benefits that He bestows on you. 25 years ago, I took a youth pastor's job down in Southern California, and there was a gentleman named Glenn. That guy, at the time, he was in his upper 50s, and that was 25 years ago. So now he's over 80 years old. He calls me about once a month, and he tells me, I'll get on the phone. He's like, hey, son, how you doing? That guy, I used to go eat biscuits and gravy with him at the local restaurant. He was just full of life. I remember one particular time, and Glenn did not know what we were going through in our lives. We were a young family. We didn't have a whole lot, sometimes not even two coins to rub together. And we were in need of groceries, and we had just exhausted the last bit of money in our bank account. I'm sure that we've all been there before. One day I heard a knock on the door. Nobody knew this. Tina and I were completely private about that. But we trusted the Lord because we were tithers, and we trusted that God was taking care of us. And Glenn came to the door, and he just knocked on the door, and he said, hey, I God just put you kids on my life, on my heart, and I wanted to bless you with something. Glenn gave us $500, And we just started crying when he left, and we're like, Glenn, thank you so much. You didn't have to do that. But I stand here today. I just got off the phone with Glenn a few days ago, and we went through our routine of talking, how's everybody, how's the family? But you know what God does when I hear his voice? He reminds me of that day. The $500 doesn't seem like a whole lot of money, but 25 years ago, that meant the world, that God would provide a small benefit that I would look back on today and realize every big benefit that has happened in my life, promotions, raises, bonuses, opportunities to travel, opportunities to share the word of God, the birth of my children. All of those have been benefits for my life, but I think God has brought those into my life because I refuse to forget the small ones as well. The roof over my head, the breath that I breathe, the meal that I eat every day, the clothes that I have to get on, Can we just be grateful for the small benefits? You know, the Bible has a lot to say about not forgetting those. Psalm 103:1-5, it says, praise the Lord. And this is a variety of this scripture kind of compressed together. There's more to it. Go read it. But it says, praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits, who forgives your sins, who heals your disease, who redeems your life from the pit, crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things. That's what God does. So he gives us benefits. The second element of understanding God's presence brings us a gratitude is the gratitude of the element of a benefactor. So we have benefits, but then we also have a benefactor. Now, benefactor, which is related to our word for factory. There it is again, bene, which is good, and factor. So good factor or a factory is part of that root word as well. So if you look at that, is one who produces good. If your perception is proper and God is good, then here's what it is. God is a good producing factory, ladies and gentlemen. So the benefits come from the benefactor who is God, and he's cranking good things out in our life all the time if we pause and we are grateful for them. God is our benefactor. So if I'm to be a grateful person, I must believe that about God. The writers of the Bible are convinced that we have a great benefactor when it comes to God and serving him. James chapter 1, verse 16 through 17. This is a fabulous statement. It says, don't be deceived. It says, my dear brothers, every good and perfect gift is from God above. It comes down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change. So there's a benefit. There's the benefit. God doesn't change, but he's a benefactor in that he gives. So this is an expression of his goodness. And then finally, that third element of recognizing the gratitude of God and his presence is that he contributes to our gratitude in that he gives us a benefit from a benefactor. And then, are you ready? We become the beneficiary. So there's the benefit, the benefactor, and then we're the recipient. We're the beneficiaries of what God gives. We're the ones who receive the good. That's you. Everybody's saying, that's me. You're the one that God wants to give to, and he's got your best interest at heart. And the beneficiary only has one crucial role for there to be gratitude, and it's they have to believe they are receiving something that they did not earn, they did not merit, or they did not deserve. From God, he gave us everything in his son Jesus. And for me, he doesn't have to give me one more thing. He brought me into this earth. He gave me life, give me my family. But I don't need one more thing from God to recognize that I'm the beneficiary of something great. And in order to do that, it helps keep me humble and that God is the provider. That's my second point. Gratitude grows in humility as well. So gratitude is being in God's presence, but gratitude also grows in our own humility. Gratitude always involves a posture of our humility. And if I believe I am owed something, then I'll not be thankful for it because I think that I'm entitled to it. You know, it's like somebody giving you a car. I'm like, oh my gosh, somebody just gave me a car. I remember we were blessed and by getting a car, someone bestowed a car up on our daughter. And you know, I sometimes I totally forget that that was a reaping from something that we sowed into someone else's life. They were in need, so we gave them a car. And you know what? When we got that car, we're like, thank you so much. We don't even know what to say, and we don't even know what to do. But it's different if somebody brings a car out and that you've paid for it. There's a different attitude. Because see, you know, we can take on the attitude, well, I'm not as grateful because I'm the one that had to pay for it. Well, listen, ladies and gentlemen, God paid a price for us through his son, Jesus Christ. And it is this, I don't deserve another thing to be able to say, God, thank you for what you have given us. The sinful human race, sometimes we are naturally entitled, and we believe our gifts, just like that car, if we paid for it, it rightfully belongs to me. And the more that we think that way, that we're entitled, then the less we will be grateful for everything that we have. We wonder why. You know, why do people who keep getting more show less gratitude? Because the bigger our sense of entitlement, then the smaller our sense of gratitude. The more things sometimes that we get, we think that we did it on our own, then the less gratitude that we have. You see, my sinful mind can convince me I'm entitled to anything that I want. And if I don't get something I want, then other people must be messing up. It must be their fault because I'm not getting what I want. And ladies and gentlemen, in a Christian framework, ingratitude is not just a psychological problem. It's not something that just happens in the mind. Ingratitude is a sin problem because we haven't recognized or perceived that everything comes down from the Father above. We read it. Everything comes to us from him. And Paul says it's the mark of a life that's opposed to God when we're not grateful to him for everything that he has given unto us. If you're a parent, you don't want to raise an ungrateful child. So imagine God in our ingratitude. He doesn't want ungrateful sons. He doesn't want ungrateful daughters. Speaking about people living a life opposed to God, Paul said in Romans chapter 1 and verse 21, it says, "For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened." You see, because they perceived themselves to be entitled, to be owed. They didn't see themselves as grateful receivers of grace in every moment. Every day, every moment, God bestows grace on us. So for that, I am thankful. And the Bible's word for ingratitude, when we're in gratitude, what we're doing is we're complaining, we're discontent, we are grumbling, we're murmuring, we're muttering things out that we shouldn't say. And you know, muttering and murmuring, it's done with such a low tone. Sometimes people can't even hear it, but it's in our hearts. The Bible says from the abundance of our heart, our mouth speaks. So I want gratitude in my heart. And if I got it in my heart, then I'm going to speak it with my mouth. Paul heard about a spirit of complaint in the church at Corinth. So he wrote to them about how Israel grumbled at Mount Sinai when they were in the desert wandering around. And the children of Israel, they failed to realize the benefits that God was giving them. Everything from shade in the sunshine and sunlight or light in the nighttime to guide them where they're going, from water when they didn't know where to get it, from meals when they didn't have them. God always provided for them, yet they found themselves murmuring. And what does God do? He was so good to them. He gave them freedom. He took care of them. He gave them guidance through the Ten Commandments. He led them to a promised land that was flowing with rich, fertile ground. And yet they continued to grumble and complain. Ladies and gentlemen, I would encourage you right now to get the right attitude when it comes to gratitude and let your heart be full of joy. They weren't grateful. And Paul says to the church at Corinth, do not grumble. And some of them continue to complain. So if I am sitting here as a spiritual pastor to you today, and I'm encouraging you in this season, I would say the greatest weapon at our disposal right now is not to grumble, because you're grumbling and you're complaining. It's not only hard on the heart, it's hard on your life. It's hard on your body. It's hard on your mind. Let me just give you a little bit of research, okay? I'm going to read a few things with you as we're kind of ramping down here to our final conclusion. Some research stories. It says more and more researchers are finding that gratitude doesn't just make you feel like a better person. It actually is good for our health. Notice this. Professor and researcher Robert A. Emmons puts it this way. Clinical trials indicate that the practice of gratitude can have a dramatic and lasting effect in a person's life. It can lower, if you have gratitude, it can lower blood pressure, improve immune function, and facilitate more efficient sleep. Another study from the University of California, San Diego of Medicine found that people who were more grateful actually had better heart health, and specifically less inflammation and healthier heart rhythms. They showed a better well-being. They were less depressed, less fatigued, and they also slept better. So gratitude has the opposite effect of stress. Stress will do the opposite of gratitude. Another study found that gratitude can boost your immune system. Another study, people who had gratitude or kept a gratitude journal and wrote things down, have a reduced dietary fat intake. My goodness, you wanna get in better shape? Be grateful, because I think God gives us the energy when we don't forget His benefits. He gives us energy in our life, and it allows us to breathe, allows us to think more clearly, and having daily gratitude can actually reduce the effects, according to the studies, of aging on the brain. It actually allows us to live longer and think younger. I'll take it. Anybody else take it? And then when you do that, you're training for gratitude. It affects your adolescence. There are studies that show how your gratitude affects your kids' gratitude. It affects their grades. It affects their community. It affects their friendships. It affects their behaviors. It affects your teenagers. So gratitude, ladies and gentlemen, man, if it does anything for us, it changes our lives. And then number three, gratitude leads to a life of blessing. I want to live a blessed life. Jesus knew what it was like to live in gratitude. His way of life, by following Him and reading about Him in the Gospels, can teach us how to train for gratitude, because he was a Jew, and every devout Jewish person was devoted to two daily forms of prayer. So according to custom, Jesus would speak blessings every day. Now think about that. Could you imagine speaking blessings every day through two prayers that would keep his heart and his life in a posture of greatness? Now, one of them we repeat all the time, Deuteronomy chapter 6, and we say it all the time to our church, verse 4 and 5. It says, "Hear, O Israel." So they're saying, I need you to hear something. It says, "The Lord our God, the Lord is one." And it gives the first and the greatest commandment: love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your strength. And of course, the second greatest commandment is to love your neighbor as yourself. You know why we do this? Because He's the benefactor. He's the one giving to us. He's the factory that's producing good. What's up there? Come down here. The goodness of heaven can come down here. And so they would pray that every day. Now, the other one is really cool, because they would pray another form of prayer, and it was just called the 18. And its complete title was the 18, check this out, benedictions. So there's another bene word. So we got benefits, benefactor, beneficiaries, and here's another word right here. And Jesus would pray, and Jews would pray two prayers. They would pray that prayer out of Deuteronomy chapter 6 every day, and then they would pray what they called the 18 benedictions, or the Amida, and they would stand when they would pray. Now, I love that word benediction, because that word, again, bene is good, but diction means words. So here it is. You want to know how to get gratitude started in your life? Good speech. Good words. Speak them over your house. Speak them over your children. Speak them over your life. And in Hebrew, a benediction was any prayer that began with the word bless. So when we say benediction, it's like, I'm going to bless you. So to bless is to always speak good, and to speak good to someone else, not just out of your mouth, but also speak good on other people. They always wanted to speak good, and they wanted to bless, and they wanted to thank God. And they would do this constantly, at least three times a day. So the prayer of 18 benedictions would daily bless areas of life. So for example, you know, you can go look this up, and they would say, God, we bless you for who you are. We bless you for our history, even though it may have been hard. We bless you for understanding. Thank you for the blessing of repentance and the blessing of forgiveness and deliverance from want. And thank you for the blessing of healing. And thank you for blessing our temple services. You know, we pray those prayers even over our own church. So benediction was just a part of the 18 benedictions that Jewish people would pray on a daily basis. You know why? Because benediction is a closing or a departing prayer of blessing. It's basically saying, I'm not leaving you without blessing you. You know why? Because I'm training for gratitude. If I'm in training for gratitude, then as we close all of our New Hope services, I say, I just ask the Lord to bless you. Keep you. May his face shine upon you. We sing that song, the Lord bless you and keep you. We say that you're the head and not the tail, that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. You know what those are? That's like our 18 benedictions as we leave you, because I would declare to you today before I get out of here and before this message concludes, I want to bless you before I leave you today. And I want to bless everybody that I see. I don't want to only want blessings on my house. I want blessings for you as well. So we're speaking good words to train for gratitude. Jewish people would pray Deuteronomy 6 and the 18 benedictions. Are you ready for this? At least 3 times a day. So as we conclude, I'm going to tell you, here's what's cool. You can create your own 18, the spirit of 18. You can create your own 18 benedictions or your own blessings. I just wrote some down. Listen to this. And there's a lot more than 18, but I just wrote my own and I started writing, and you can do that. And here's where you get to exercise this message today. Get a Bible and a journal and write these blessings down. Get your device. Put them somewhere where you can see them. Because I just started writing. Bless you, God. I bless my wife. I bless my children. I bless my church. I bless my health. I bless my finances. And for all of those that you're like, how can I do 18 blessings in a day? I'll keep going. I bless my friendships. I bless my future husband. I bless my future wife. I bless my travel. Bless my car. Amen. I bless my home. I bless my mind. I bless my country. I bless my future. I bless my school. I bless my education. I bless my online education. I'm going to stop complaining about my online education or having to do this. I know we've all got to do it. And I've grumbled and murmured and complained about it myself. But I'm done. I'm going to start blessing Macy's education as she goes back to school and believes she's going to have the best school year of her life. I bless my business. I bless my neighbors. I bless our doctors. I bless my trash man. I bless my dog. I bless my cat. I bless my food. Are you getting the picture? Listen, it is about understanding where those blessings come from and then us putting those blessings into practice. That's why we encourage you to even take a prayer like the Lord's Prayer and just add it to your 18 benedictions. Now, if you can only come up with 10, that's wonderful. But the key here is to put them into practice. In Acts chapter 3, Peter and John were going into the temple, and the Bible says that they were going there at the time of prayer, and it was about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. You know why they were going there? They were going to pray the 18 benedictions. They were going to pray, God, we just love you with all of our heart, our soul, and our mind, and our strength. They were going to take time out and just say, God, we bless you. Because see what happens, gratitude, when it's in our heart, then all of a sudden it will rise up in our imperfections as well. Gratitude will rise up in our broken world. It'll rise up when we are dealing with broken people. It'll rise up when you're dealing with a loved one or a husband or a wife or a child or a friend or a family member who maybe are imperfect, because gratitude arises in imperfection. And it's going to be really hard what I'm getting ready to say, but when was the last time that you said, I'm grateful for them even though they're not perfect or they're imperfect? I know they've done some things and we've been in some tough, challenging issues, but can we just say thank you, God? Because we're giving gratitude and I'm bestowing a blessing on their life in hopes maybe that you're going to mend that broken relationship. Because ladies and gentlemen, if I wait for perfect people and perfect circumstances to be grateful, then I'm going to have to wait for a long time. But if I begin to bless, then it becomes a part of my spirit. It becomes a part of my life. And I feel like in our society, we are always in danger of being thankful only when good things come our way. But when was the last time that we were transformed and being transformed by God by learning that we have to see God in a way that we've never seen him before in these imperfections and in bad situations? Because the Bible says, "For I know that in all things God is at work for all of our good." So I'm grateful today. I want you to be grateful today. I can perceive God even in our present imperfections. I just came from home and my father, I don't know that I've ever seen him just have a bad day. He is the most positive guy that I know. And I heard in a teaching the other day from a conference, a pastor telling about someone who was similar. And he said, I never knew the man to have a bad day, even when he had contracted cancer in his body and it would eventually have taken his life. In his sickness, he was more grateful for who God was than he was when he didn't have any illness. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I know that we are living in imperfect times. We have an imperfect government. We have imperfect school systems. And all of us, we say it all of the time, are imperfect. None of us have been made perfect. But God is righteousness. He's right. There's evil in the world. And that's why Satan came into the world to produce this chaos and this evil. But God is here among us. So that sickness in our bodies, the problems that we're having at home, the problems we're having with education, I mean, you can name it all. The problems that you may be having in your marriages or in your finance or getting job, whatever that is. Listen, that's all brought on through evil and because sin came into the world and God sent his son Jesus to make it right today. So I want you to begin to shift your attitude. If you've got to make your own 18 benedictions and you've just got to take time, if you just take 5 minutes a day at the same time, statistically, there was research done that says if you just take 5 minutes and you at the same time every day write 3 things down that you're grateful for, it is proven that it will change your life. You have to do that every day. You got to begin to see the good in everything. Now, I know my dad always has a good day, but I know it's not true. He doesn't always. But he has perception to where he looks through and he finds the good in what God is doing in the earth. Can we say that today? Here's how I close. Can we say that today? How's your perception right now? How's your perception of some of the imperfections that's going on? But how's your perception of God? You know, God can help you change how you see things immediately. He wants to give you a benefit today. Are you ready? You know what that is? Salvation. He wants to give you a benefit of peace. He wants to give you the benefit of joy. He wants to give you the benefit of relationships and friendships. He wants to give you the benefit of forgiveness and grace. You see, he wants to see that in your life as the benefactor because he's the one that provides those for you. You see, no one else is doing that. No one is providing for you and has provided for you like God has. That breath, that came from God. God, thank you for that breath. You see, he's a factory producing good in your life if you just choose to see it. All you have to do is believe that he's doing it, and you ready? You become the beneficiary. You become the beneficiary. I get to receive the gift of salvation today. And when I receive that gift of salvation, like every one of us, we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. We can't be perfect, but Jesus is, so he takes our sin. I receive that gift by having a moment with him that I promise you, you'll look back and say, the rest of my life, I'll be grateful for that moment that God worked a miracle in my life and that he gave me salvation. You become the beneficiary. All you have to do is receive it today. You receive it through this prayer. We're gonna say a prayer together. I want you to say it with me. And then I'm gonna tell you a little bit about some resource that we want to give you as we close, okay? Would you bow your head and pray with me, okay? Say this prayer. Dear Jesus, come into my life today. I need you, God. I need your benefits. I may have forgotten about you, but I want to know you in a new way. So Lord, I need you. I receive your benefit. I open my heart. I confess with my mouth and believe that I can have salvation today. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Hey, God bless you. Man, church, wow. Can we just say praise God for all of those who just said that prayer? And if you said that prayer, whatever platform you are on, you can either hit the connect card there or the card that says, I received Jesus. Let us know that you did that. Somebody on our team will reach out to you. If you're on YouTube, just make sure to hit us at info@newhopepeople.com. If you need prayer in any way or want to share about some of the goodness that God has done in your life, let us know today. And then what we want to do is send you a book that just helps you start to follow Jesus, a Bible that you can begin to read about the life of Jesus, and then some next steps to get you connected. We're pulling for you. Have gratitude in your heart this week, and we love you. Can't wait to see you next week. Let's close with one more song of worship. God bless you. You are here.
Thank you for joining us online today. I hope you enjoyed the worship and the word and that you were transformed. If you ask Christ into your heart for the very first time today, we say welcome to the family of God and we celebrate with you. That is one of the greatest decisions that you will ever make. And because of that, we want to know. So please email us at info@newhopepeople.com. You are not alone, and we want to walk this journey out with you. Also, if you need prayer for anything, we want to partner with you and pray with you. We want to see your prayers turned into praises. So use the email listed below and reach out to us today. We invite you for our online services next Sunday at 8:45, 10:15, and 11:45. Have a blessed day.